Here's something unusual I found at the thrift store. It's called the Advisor Monitor Broadcast Receiver Model 805 by Johnson Electronics Incorporated. And it's in this very angular shaped cabinet, all plastic, but it has wood grain on it, which is what caught my eye. On this side we have something labeled external, probably for an external speaker, and a power jack. On the front is a speaker grill and a red LED. That side has nothing. The back just has this FCC ID sticker saying it's made in Taiwan. The bottom has a 9-volt battery compartment. On the top we have a pull-out antenna, a listen and standby switch, and a volume control. So let's install a battery and see what it does.
Okay.
That's what the volume turned all the way down.
The leaves are coming back, and so I worry that what was...
All right. Let's pull out the antenna.
This is on the media.
Seems to be picking up our NPR station, 93.9 WNYC. But the reception is not very good, and even with the volume turned all the way down, it's still playing pretty loudly.
A look at the price homeowners and towns are willing to pay for beachfront property that's falling into the ocean. It's next time on The Takeaway, weekday afternoons at 3 on 93.9 FM.
Also, even when I have the switch in the standby position, it seems like the audio amplifier is still getting power because I can hear scratchiness in the volume control. So this is a fixed frequency FM broadcast receiver.
They're gonna go bad. And the guy is like, are you kidding me? He starts laughing like, how can the cell phones go bad? You know, you're so crazy, man. I'm so in the night of this.
But notice, even when I have it in the standby position, when I first apply power to the battery,
we as performers,
the red light comes on and it starts receiving.
Also, and that's the relationship that we have with our audience, trying to laugh about the situation.
If I switch it to listen and then back to standby, the light goes out. So clearly there's some kind of trigger to make it turn on even in the standby position and illuminate the LED. So to try to discover the original purpose of this receiver, I had to do some digging. I looked up the FCC ID number on the FCC website, and it turned up a result for Johnson Electronics of Castleberry, Florida, dated June 16th, 1982. And it says it's for a frequency range of 88 to 108. megahertz, which is the FM broadcast band, but that still doesn't give us any details about the purpose of this thing. FloridaMemory.com has many photos of Johnson Electronics from the 1950s and 1960s showing some of their workers and the devices they made, and they even have a photo of the building that Johnson Electronics was located in. RadioMuseum.org says they made special receivers for Seberg, but I don't think that would have anything to do with the receiver I have. But finally, in the September 28th, 1981 issue of InfoWorld magazine, I found a match for what the device I have is. It says Dow Jones plans micro news service. It says it'll use microcomputer technology to allow subscribers to keep track of specific business information. The radio broadcast service will allow users to monitor particular companies or commodities by keying codes into a specially designed receiver. The radio would then switch on when that code was sent by Dow Jones, receiving the relevant information. The system will transmit over an FM sideband radio signal now generally used for stereo broadcasting and for background music services such as Muzak. Subscribers will rent special receivers made by Johnson Electronics of Castleberry, Florida at a price that may be in the $25 to $35 range. So the service will be introduced sometime next spring, which would have been in 1982, in several cities around the country. It says it's remarkably similar to data casting, a method of sending digital information that has frequently been proposed by Jim Warren, president of the West Coast Computer Fair. That was where the founders of Apple Computer got their start. It says, no longer do we have to cut down trees to make paper to put ink on and burn up a large amount of gasoline to deliver a small amount of news a day late. So this seems to be a simplified version of what was described in that InfoWorld article, which is tuned to a specific FM broadcast station, and subscribers would rent these radios. And in the standby position, it'll wait for a special subcarrier to be transmitted by that station, which would automatically switch it on and illuminate this LED, or the person could just turn it on at any time.
Playlist. This is Will Toledo of Carson to Headrest, station. And you're listening to my dinner party soundtrack.
So it seems the intent of these would be for business people who are interested in stocks and commodities and other business-related news like that would have one of these on their desk, and whenever any of that relevant information was being broadcast on the radio station, it would automatically switch on and start playing. But the same page of that InfoWorld magazine, which describes these receivers, shows what eventually made them obsolete, and that is online news services. Here they call it video text, but more generally it was just any kind of online service, or eventually the internet.
The internet is not something that you just dump something on. It's not a big truck. It's a series of tubes.
And they talk about Dow Jones. Well, Dow Jones already had their own online service at the time in the 1980s. It was very expensive, but anybody could subscribe to it. And instead of waiting for an FM broadcast to transmit the relevant information the people were looking for, they could pull up anytime they wanted just by connecting to that online service, and within a few keystrokes they could find it. Here it is taken apart. There are no screws, it's all just clipped together. And it's clearly a custom-made circuit board. It's not just a off-the-shelf radio receiver that somebody added on extra circuitry to. Here's the antenna, so this is the front end, and there's a couple trimmers there, so those might be to adjust the frequency. And then there's two more trimmers here, which might be for the special decoding. In fact, there's a crystal, 41.5. That might be the subcarrier frequency it's receiving. If that is 41.5 kilohertz, that would mean whatever a station was transmitting the special code, they would not be able to transmit FM stereo, because that involves a 38 kilohertz subcarrier, and then the left minus right audio information would be taking up this frequency here and preventing it from being used. But most likely any FM station in 1982 that was broadcasting this kind of financial news would probably be in mono anyway. Even today, a lot of FM stations that are not primarily music-based transmit in mono, including WNYC, the station this one is tuned to. They generally only turn on stereo when they're actually playing music. The chips in here do have 1982 date codes, especially this one back here, which you can't really see that well on camera. And that InfoWorld article talked about keying in a special code into the receiver to set it up. So I think that might have been their original idea, but this is what they had to settle for. So there's no kind of microprocessor or microcontroller in here, no way to key in codes or anything. It's just all set up by these coils and these trimmers, and that's basically it. So I think they had bigger ideas for this technology than what was actually implemented, and that's what you can see here. And just to be clear, even though this most likely uses a special subcarrier to trigger that automatic turning on of the receiver when the relevant information was being broadcast, the actual audio it's receiving is not from a subcarrier, it's from the normal FM broadcast. That's why we were able to hear it playing the radio station, even though the special service this was originally designed for has long since been discontinued.
Today the Dow was down 28 points, a tenth of a percent. The Nasdaq shed 5 points, essentially flat. S&P 500 lost a point, pretty much unchanged.
Now this Muppet News Flash! On Wall Street today, commodity experts were amazed as beef fell dramatically. Oh no!
So computers basically rendered this little receiver obsolete within just a few years of it being made. But I still think it looks neat sitting on a desk.